This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning. Amen. And welcome to worship here at Triune Mercy Center. We are delighted to have you joining us, whether in person or online. I have a few announcements this morning. The first is that in the coming weeks, we're going to have some exciting things taking place, some events to announce. So I just want to draw your attention to our calendar in the back of the bulletin. And if you're online, you can download our bulletin on our website on the sermons page. But today doesn't have a lot of those things, but we are busy planning for what is to come, and we will be announcing that in the coming weeks. So I just wanted to pique your curiosity. Beginning today, the walk-up window here at the Mercy Center will close between 10:30 and noon. And we won't serve any food until noon. So that is a new change, but we will have food. And today I know there's chicken from Buncombe Street, from the Boy Scouts. And I hear that that is an annual thing, and it's very good. So just know that food is available at the walk-up window. Also, Dr. Jervy will be doing eye exams, as he does them every other Tuesday. But there are some appointments available on Tuesday, May the 25th. So if you would like your eyes checked by Dr. Jervy here, please contact Rhonda, and her phone number is in the bulletin. I would ask that you please silence your cell phones at this time if you haven't already. It's fun to receive calls from God in the middle of worship. This morning also, I added one verse to the scripture reading. So if you have a pencil or a pen and this is your thing, if you'll add verse 13 in that list. So it goes verses 1 through 5, 11 through 13, and 16 and 17. Also, hopefully you received a communion packet. We will be doing that for the next two communions, and hopefully after that we can return to some bread and cup here at the front, but we will see how that goes. But for today, you have communion packets, and Tandy will be given instructions right before we offer an invitation at the Lord's table. If you do not have one of those communion packets and need it, see one of our ushers at the back of the sanctuary. That's a lot of announcements. But as always, I want to thank everybody who made today's worship service possible. For the musicians, thank you. For our AV and sound live stream folks, thank you. For our ushers, for our readers, for the staff of Triune, thank you for making this worship service possible this day. So now, let us turn our hearts and our minds and our souls over to the worship of our living God. If you would, please join me in your bulletins or look at the words on your screen as we read responsively from Psalm 22. From you, O God, comes my praise in the great congregation. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. Let us worship God.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. I am so happy to be up here leading you in praise and worship this morning. So just remember, there is no greater love than God's love. You knew my
Good morning, Triune. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Claiming the promises of God sealed in our baptism, we humbly confess the reality of sin in personal and common life. Confident in God's grace, let us confess our sin before God and one another, praying together the prayer of confession, found in your bulletins and on the screen. God of all hope and joy, we confess that we continue to live in fear. You make us branches of your vine, but we do not seek to abide in you. You extend your promise to all, yet we grasp at your grace as if it was our possession. Lord of love, have mercy on us and forgive us. Grow us in your perfect life, the love that casts out all fear, so that we may truly love one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray. You have already been cleansed by the word that God has spoken to you. In baptism, God claimed you and joined you to Christ as branches to a vine. Believe the promise given to you. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Let us now come before God with our other prayers, beginning with a few moments of silent prayer. Let us now join with all creation in praying for the good of the earth, saying, Holy God, hear our prayer. O God, we give you thanks for your Holy Spirit, whose work of creation continues in us. We give you thanks that through Christ Jesus you have shown your love for this earth, which you made. We pray that all the world may know your power and your goodness. Holy God, hear our prayer. Word of life, reveal the wonder of your world to all people. Show us anew what lives around us, over us, beneath us, within us. Enliven the church with your spirit, that we may honor your earth with responsible care. Holy God, hear our prayer. Almighty God, tend to the needs of our sisters and brothers who endure disasters caused by weather, war, famine, sickness, or greed. Strengthen all who are in peril, especially the people of Israel, India, and Brazil and Israel these days. We give you thanks that you are our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Giver of all good things, bring trust and goodwill to the nations of the world. Let peacemakers reign wherever there is conflict. Give wisdom to leaders and hope to the poor. Good healer, we pray for all who are in need of comfort. Comfort those who mourn. Uphold those who are sick, or holding vigil, or awaiting words of hope. Especially those we name now, silently. Trusting in your mercy, we commend to you all those we have named and those whose needs are known only to you. In the name of your Son, Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Oh,
But it won't come cheap. It takes everything to love more than a dream. God help us to love.
God help us to love.
God help us to love.
God's people say, amen. Last week we read from John's Gospel where Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd. Just like last week's image, this week's image, the vine, is another extended metaphor which borrows even from Old Testament imagery for Israel. Now today's text comes after Jesus has the Last Supper, where he gathers with his disciples around the table and he blesses and breaks bread with them. And then he washes their feet and he gives them a new commandment to love one another as he has loved them. A commandment that is repeated and even amplified in today's text. Jesus gives these final words for three whole chapters in John's Gospel, and he gives them to the disciples. And this morning we find Jesus, in his last words, offers his last I am statement, the seventh one. And like the others, each image is familiar to Jesus' followers and points to the relationships between God, the Father, with Jesus, and with each other. But before turning to God's word for us this day, first, let us pray. Love, 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 love. The gospel in one word is love. Love your neighbor as yourself, for God is love. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today's gospel reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, with the various verses listed in your bulletin, with the addition of that verse 13. Listen to a word from God. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vineyard keeper. He removes any of my branches that don't produce fruit, and he trims any branch that produces fruit so that it will produce even more fruit. You are already trimmed because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. A branch can't produce fruit by itself, but must remain in the vine. Likewise, you can't produce fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, then you will produce much fruit. Without me, you can't do anything. I have said these things to you so that my joy will be in you and your joy will be complete. This is my commandment. Love each other just as I have loved you. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. You didn't choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you could go and produce fruit and so that your fruit could last. As a result, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. One of my favorite writers is Anne Lamott. I like her because she's honest, funny, and a little crass at times about her faith. But most of all, I like her because she loves to follow Jesus, and she does it knowing of her own desperate need of God's grace and forgiveness. She writes, quote, "My understanding of the kingdom of heaven, both as it is inside my heart and as Jesus said, and in the bigger world, is that it's a come-as-you-are party and that you are welcome to come to the table. People who are hungry and thirsty and needing rest. I understand that I am welcome and I am accepted exactly the way I am. It's like that dumb bumper sticker that says, you are loved exactly the way that you are by God, but God loves you too much to let you stay like this." End quote. In John's gospel, John reiterates Jesus' desire to be in relationship with us as we are given an image, a tangible image, of Jesus being the vine and God being the vineyard keeper. However, the Old Testament image is that of a God who is the vineyard keeper and Israel who is the vine, the grapevine. God tended Israel and pruned her and prepared her so that she might bear fruit. But here, Jesus changed the metaphor because he can do that. He's Jesus. Here, Jesus says that he is the vine. And God is the vineyard keeper, and Jesus' disciples are the branches. As the sheep follow and are cared for by the good shepherd, so too are the branches to cling to and be nourished by the vine. However, in various seasons, the branches need to be pruned in order to produce more fruit. Now, as an amateur gardener, I've learned through failures that I need to prune the roses at a certain time. Then they will produce more blooms, but if I prune them at the wrong time, they will die. Amen? I have one right now in my bed to prove it. The same is with us. But have you ever tried to grow something that was just from a branch? Now, I know this isn't children's sermon, but we're all children of God. Amen? So I'm a visual person. So, $1 million for anybody who could tell me how we can grow some fruit from this branch. Can we do it? Well, that's putting it in something. I'm talking as is right now, cut off from its vine. Now, I've got this orange. Maybe I could tape it. No? So it's still not going to grow, right? I hope there are no bugs living on this branch. But that's how it is with us. If we aren't connected to the vine, it just isn't going to work. Because a branch doesn't grow fruit without being attached to its source, to the vine. That single branch could do nothing apart from the vine. Yeah, you could put it in water, but you have to do something. So neither can we produce fruit if we're cut off from our relationship with Jesus. Apparently, the best grapes I've learned in visiting some vineyards are produced closest to the central vine, where the nutrients, are most concentrated. So you always want to get the grapes that are closest to the vine. But what is the fruit that we are meant to produce? Well, the first thing that comes to my mind is the fruit of the Spirit: joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. But there's really only one task for us to do, and that is to remain, to hang in there for the long haul. For example, we cannot produce joy on our own without being in relationship with Jesus. I'm talking about pure joy. Remain in me, and I will remain in you, Jesus says. In other words, live in me, make your home in me, just as I do in you. Unlike branches on a real vine, though, we get to choose to remain in Christ or not. If we choose to do so, we will have to coexist with other fellow branches. And that can get messy, crowded, tangled, and oh so beautiful. A life that's deeply rooted and wildly fertile. But how do we remain connected to Christ? Well, here are a few ways. One way is by inviting the Holy Spirit to remain in us, asking the Holy Spirit to remain in us, or pausing as I try to teach my kids and offering a prayer before they consume their food, or at any time to pray, recognizing that Christ is always with us, or trusting Jesus' strength and not relying only on our own strength. Or being intentional about surrounding ourselves with a community of faith, or by reading and studying Scripture by ourselves and with others, or by seeking justice for those who have been wronged, or by remembering our baptism, or by breaking bread together at Christ's table, or by serving those in need in Jesus' name. Those are just a few. But then there's this famous prayer of St. Patrick, which invites Christ to remain close by. You've heard it before, maybe. If you haven't, listen closely to this prayer. Christ with me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, Christ in me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ on my right, Christ on my left, Christ when I lie down, Christ when I sit down, Christ in the heart of everyone who thinks of me, Christ in the mouth of everyone who speaks of me, Christ in the eye that sees me, Christ in the ear that hears me. I don't know about you all, but the last two lines, I invite you to let them sink in for a minute. Christ in the eye that sees me, Christ in the ear that hears me. When I was leading one time at Montreat Conference Center in North Carolina, a small group leader was upset about something I had said, and they told me so. Well, a wise mentor of mine had invited me years before to try a spiritual practice of seeing the face of Christ in every person I met. You see, our job is to be who we say we are and who God says we are. Carriers of the divine image. When you see Christ in others, you will see and live differently. Well, while difficult, this invitation has often allowed me to offer compassion instead of becoming angry and defensive. Maybe I'm the only one. To listen and to dwell in Christ, therefore loving the other person, seeing Christ in the other person. Because as God's word tells us, abiding in Jesus means abiding in Jesus' love. And while it is true that apart from Christ, we can do nothing, the opposite is also true. Amen? in Christ, through Christ, and with Christ, we can do all things. Not because of us, but because of Jesus Christ, the true vine. Jesus tells his disciples about his connection with them so that his joy would be in them. People would see it in us, and our joy would then be complete. Again, I'm visual, but when we experience Christ's joy in us, it's contagious. It's really difficult to hold a grudge or be PO'd at someone around pure joy. Bearing fruit, when it counts, grows from a union with Jesus. But keep in mind that branches don't live off their own fruit. The fruit is for someone else. Have you ever seen pure joy in others? They just can't seem to contain themselves. I wish I could show you this video, but I'm going to describe it and do my best. And then I'm going to have a link under our video on our Facebook page, if you have Facebook and want to look. There's a video that circulated on social media a few years ago of a 6-year-old girl named Lauren Patterson from First Baptist Church in Dixon, Tennessee. Maybe some of you saw her. She is one example of someone filled with Christ's joy and is sharing her joy with the world, only she doesn't know it. This video of her rejoicing through song and dance, and I'm talking this, the only one in the whole choir, went viral, and within a few weeks, over 5 million people had viewed it. The Today Show featured her and quoted, "This girl is bringing joy to people in a gloomy world. There ain't nothing gonna steal her joy." That's the name of the song these kids were singing in the video. Ain't nothing gonna steal our joy. And Lauren believed it, and she is believable because she is full of joy. Nothing's going to steal her joy because Lauren is from the vine. That's a good thing because the fruit is not for her. It's for those of us who need to see it, to be reminded of the fruit that comes from the one who finds their home in Jesus Christ. And a child shall lead them. Notice that the key to remaining in Jesus is obeying his commandments. It's what he requires of his disciples. So then, what are his commandments? There are many, but they all seem to boil down to one thing. Love. Y'all are awake. Love. While producing fruit can mean the general Christian lifestyle, it points here specifically to the act of loving one another as Christ loves us. Jesus said, "No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends." We are called Jesus' friends. The resurrection, when Jesus Christ laid down his life for his friends, is the greatest act of love. For God so loved the world. Will Willimon, a Methodist bishop originally from here in Greenville, stated that the most eloquent testimony to the reality of the resurrection is not an empty tomb or a well-orchestrated pageant on Easter Sunday, but rather a group of ragtag people whose life together is so radically different, so completely changed from the way the world builds community, that there is no explanation other than something decisive that happened in history. Another scholar says, "The proof that God raised Jesus from the dead is not the empty tomb, but the full hearts of his transformed disciples. The crying evidence that he lives is not a vacant grave, but a spirit-filled fellowship. Not a rolled-away stone, but a carried-away, love-filled church." Amen? You see, love is the essential fruit of our faith. It's not the kind of love expressed when you say, like my child, "Wow, I love chicken nuggets." Or the love in a romantic movie. Or the love expressed in a card. No, this kind of love is called agape love, and it does not come from us. It is love shared between us because it is only possible through the indwelling of God's Spirit. You can't actually muster it up yourself. Because of our own love, you all know this, we love imperfectly. We love awkwardly and with selfish motives and begrudging hearts. Our own love on our own can be show-offy or miserly or only given when we feel like it. But the love of God for the children of God is no such thing. And God desires God's children to love one another too much for God to leave it to what is on our own hearts. You see, agape love is how we love Jesus' friends. It's how we show care and hospitality toward others based solely on their belovedness to God. All whom Jesus loves and calls friends have dignity and honor and should be treated as such. I think Jesus says for us to abide in his love so that we can agape love one another. It's the only way it's possible. Otherwise, I will love people that I like, and I'll reject others' love of me when I don't feel worthy. And that's just not what God had in mind for me or for you. And only when we see ourselves and others as Jesus' friends, as God's beloved children, is it possible to love with the heart of God. When we abide in the Word of God, when we see Christ in the eyes that see us, this kind of love is not a feeling, it is an action. This agape love is our daily mission. Jesus reminds his disciples, and that means us, that he chose us, we did not choose him. And as disciples, we are called to take our leading and our sustenance from Christ. But being chosen doesn't mean we're free to act however we want. In response to being chosen by God, by God's grace, we are called to obedience, to discipleship, to relationship with Jesus and our neighbors. Sharing God's love. And this, my friends, is no easy or small task. Because the world is not yet what God desires. And temptations and isms still abound. So how are you connected to the vine? What fruit are you producing in this world? Because the only fruit we're sharing with this world is the fruit that we produce together. However, we produce fruit not by squeezing it out of ourselves, but because we are extensions of the vine, pruned by the vineyard keeper. So let us find our home in God's word and place our trust there. Therefore, producing lasting fruit and loving as Christ loves us. It's all that easy and it's all that hard. But with Christ, nothing is impossible because love wins. Help us to love. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Here at Triune, we practice an open table, which means that all who long to encounter Jesus are welcome at this holy meal. It is not time yet to open your little communion packets, but I want to explain how to use them. So if you would please take them, and if you do not have one, please raise your hand and an usher can bring you one. Okay, thank you, Tony, if you can bring him one. And if you keep your hand up so he can see where to come, thank you. If you will look at the top of it, you can see, why is my microphone so loud? You will see the wafer on the top, and the tab on the end has two parts to it. And so in order to get to the wafer, you will need to lift only the thin, clear plastic layer first to get to the wafer. And then only later will you then lift the entire tab to get to the cup. And you have a tissue because it may be messy. God prepares this feast for us and for all people. This feast of good things, a feast of peace. So come and taste, eat and be filled, drink and never thirst again. Let us pray. Merciful and loving God, we give you thanks for this feast that you have set before us, a feast of your love for us, a feast of your mercy toward us, your presence with us, and your faithfulness which sustains us. We rejoice that you use common things like bread and juice for your holy purposes. And we rejoice that you empower ordinary people like us for your holy purposes. Thank you, O God, for this holy meal and for all the mysterious and yet powerful ways that we encounter you in this meal. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. On the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread, and when he had blessed it and given thanks, he broke it, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." Friends, this is the feast of God for the people of God. Come and be filled. So now I invite you to take your packet and peel up the thin plastic layer on the top to get the wafer, the bread of life. And now, if you would carefully open the full top to reveal the juice in the cup. This is the cup of salvation. And if you would place your empty cup in your tissue now, and then if you would drop it in the garbage cans on the way out, please. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for giving us this bread of life and this cup of salvation. Thank you for giving us Jesus Christ, who is the true bread from heaven and who is the true vine, to whom we long to be connected. We pray that this holy meal might nourish us that we might produce fruit for the good of your people. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Jesus' disciples and friends. Scripture tells us, Jesus says, I am the vine and you are the branches. Remain in me as I remain in you. Because we can't produce fruit on our own. So go out and remain in Jesus as we all produce lasting fruit and love one another. As Christ loves us. It's all that easy, and it's all that hard. But with Christ, love always wins. And now may the grace of God, the love and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the friendship and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, branches, now and forevermore, world without end. Amen. Go in peace.